Hey guys, Garrett97 again. This time, a review of the 100 scale Gundam F90 ADS type Assault, Destroyed, and Support. And these guys were originally just a series of modicas, later converted into a manga, and then featured in a video game, Formula Wars 0122. So, before we have a look at the model kit itself, we got this inserted into the box. And this was essentially where the first runner was on. And this was kind of advertising their system injection they had going on here, which is essentially molding multiple colors on the same part. And along that, we get some English explanation of what the various hard points are used for, and some are in English, such as the one at the top here. We get 6 tons propellant straight, we get armament clusters, whatever that means, and ammunition pack is apparently spelled in one word. Also, I love the text down here. Designer Kunio Okawara, he has made another design newly for us, and dramatic pause. Bandai has just embodied his draft in plastic models. We did every technique we could do. Now his arts are coming true and moving. Dramatic pause. Full color mold. Snap kit. Dramatic pause. When you open the box, you know another great Gundam from Bandai. Well, let's get back to that in a second, shall we? And back to the base model. So first of all, it's pretty good looking. Not too bad for a model kit from the 90s. Well, from 1990, so can't really get any earlier into the 90s. And overall, it's pretty good when it comes to colors. But first, let's show you guys the system injection molding thing they had going on. So essentially what it means is the red, the yellow, and the white were all just one piece. You didn't have to put them in. Same goes for a chest here, the yellow, the red, the yellow on top were all just already molded in there. The chin was also molded in there, didn't have to put it on, but it gives us one problem, and that is very colorful nub marks. So we have a red one here, red one on the other side, then we also have a red one showing on this side, because of course the colors had to go in somewhere, so that's kind of a bummer, and probably why they stopped doing the system injection molding. Also probably because, well, already putting parts together on a model kit would probably be kind of counterintuitive. Moving on with the colors we get for this machine, just for the base model we get quite nice dark blue for the body, all the hard points which are gonna be removed, the bottom of the feet, and that's about it. We have the standard Gundam white, I would say we have red, but the only red we're getting is from the system injection molding, so there's no real only red on there. Then for yellow parts that we get separate, just these here, and then this V-fin was also system injection molding. You had the white molded and the red, which makes me wonder why they couldn't just make the head jewel system injection molded too. Really using all the techniques you could there, Bandai. Or should I say Bandai, because they put it in caps lock. Then moving on to stickers, we're getting a lot of stickers. Holy sticker, this is a bunch. So the good news is you kinda don't have to paint it, but these stickers, well, they're not the greatest. The flat ones are gonna be pretty good. You have the black and red one here, here, the red and black one here and here. You have the gray one that goes inside the vents, but as you can see there, the stickers aren't always gonna be the best shape. Then you have these ones that wrap around, and that is gonna be happening a lot. These thrusters really don't like to stay in there. The other one's probably gonna fall off in a minute. So let's put that to the side. These stickers. So these are kinda hit and miss. On some of my F90s, they really like to stay, such as this one, but on one other one I have, these stickers really don't wanna stay at all. And this one here, it's kinda funny because it had a gray outline. So what you are supposed to do is you put it on top of there, because this entire thing is supposed to be gray. But yeah, I thought it looked much better to just cut off the gray and put it in there as it is supposed to be. The same kind of sticker is on his butt here. He had like a little gray outline, which made it look really weird, because he just had that, yeah, he just had a flat thruster look on it. Then we have gray when it wraps around here, which surprisingly stays on quite well. We have gray on here. Then the eyes. Oh yeah, that's also a very nice thing they did there. You don't get a sticker, but the eyes are nice translucent blue plastic, same as the Beam Sabers here. Now, one unfortunate thing is you don't get, like with the Silhouette Formula F91 models, you don't get a sticker to put behind there. But what you can do is you cut off a little piece and then you stick it to the back of the head. Now, why you want to do that is when you peel it off, the back of these stickers is very nice metallic. So that is gonna give your stick, it's gonna give your eyes a nice shine to them, and kind of makes it feel like there's more to them, like they have more substance, not like it's just a hollow thing in there. But moving on with the stickers, because there's still a lot more to come. We have the gray ones that wrap around the shoulders, going to the back. We have red one here, yellow ones that wrap around there, yellow one that wraps around there. The triangles here and there, and on the other side, and well, that went onto the ground. Fantastic. We have the white ones wrap around the hands, and then we also have another white one for the trigger finger hand. As you can see, this is coming loose and really doesn't like to stay. So the stickers are going to be hit and miss. Some of them are going to be really good, others are going to be really crap, like this one here. And then it still seems to depend on the model kit. But those are all the stickers we get for the model itself. Let's look at the articulation. And how great are their techniques gonna be? Head goes up, down, rotates around. It's just on a peg, so it's not gonna do anything else. Then the arms will rotate around, go up, down, rotate around. And this is what I was talking about. Great design technology. This is a major pain. This is the biggest, one of the biggest problems of this kit. This peg does not want to stay into that joint over there. The poly cap is too deep in there and the peg is too short. So even with nothing attached to the arm, if you're just moving it around or trying things, the arm is gonna come loose every single time you move it. And it's gonna get old really, really quickly. And that is before you're gonna put nice heavy stuff on it. This was a horrible design decision. I cannot understand why they didn't make the peg longer. So, arm bends at one joint for 60 degrees, maybe. Then the hands are on ball joints, will wiggle around, turn around, and do everything a ball joint does. Then the waist won't move. Bandai used every design thing they could do, but including waist articulation wasn't part of that great arsenal of technology they had available. Then, front skirts move up a bit, legs go up, well, about that far until it decides to peg off. So that's about as far as you're gonna get, and then it will fly off there. Then the legs will also go backwards about that far, will go out like that, and will also rotate around a little bit. Legs are on a single joint for about 90 degrees, and something that you don't see all the time, the legs will also go side to side. And I guess this can be really interesting for action poses, if you want to be a bit more to the side. It's an interesting thing. So really, for the more action-y poses, if you really want to put him in a dynamic pose, that's actually pretty cool. Then the legs, well, the feet go down really far, go up, left, right, until those things pop off. So that's about as far as you're gonna go until those things pop off. Oh well. And they will turn around as well. Yet another thing you will notice with Bandai's great technology they use in here is things do kind of like to pop off. One final thing I'm going to mention that really likes to pop off is the Scourger, and you can see how easily I remove this. This is going to be a problem later on. And just put this back on there. There we go. And now let's talk accessories, because that is where this thing is going to shine. Or at least it should shine. First, let's look at the basic accessories we're getting with the F90 itself. We're getting a shield. Now, this looks pretty nice, doesn't it? Well, it was all in white, and everything else are stickers. One giant sticker here, a big one here, smaller one on top, and an even smaller one in the middle. Then two black ones right there. The annoying thing with this is there's a 90 on here, but we're not getting any clear marking stickers. Rub transfer, water slide, whatever. The only way to get the 90 is with this sticker, so it's almost as if they're forcing us to put this sticker on there. Or, well, you gotta find a way to replicate that. So that's a bit unfortunate. Then we have a movable handle, goes up and down in the hand, but it's not really gonna be the best connection. So really the only way to hold it is to kinda let it sag and hit the ground and make it stand that way. That's really the only good way to do it, because otherwise, yeah. And look at that, the arm is about to fall off. Well, yep, there we go. So let's quickly put this to the side, put the arm back on, and bring in the beam rifle here. This is the standard beam rifle. Nothing too much to say about it. You have the dedicated trigger finger hand. You have this peg here, which will attach it to some hard points. You have the one here on the side. Let's... Oh, there we go. So you can put it on the side. It's not going to be in there really securely. It's going to fall off quite easily, but you can still put it in there. Then there it goes, and off goes the arm again. So yeah, it sits in there pretty naturally. Also, the ball joint is kind of at an angle to make sure it sits really naturally in there. And overall, it's a really nice looking thing, nicely detailed. Unfortunately, no moving handle, but it's a cool thing. Now, let's talk attachment packs. So the first thing we gotta do is to remove all the hard points to reveal the holes in which we can put all of the extra equipment. And one immediate unfortunate thing I have to say about these attachment packs is they are all molded in one color. That is really the one big unfortunate thing, because they kind of took the main color, but of course all of them have so many detail colors that it's just a shame. And as you can see, you can pretty easily remove all of this. There we go, let's start off with the Assault Pack, which is my favorite one from the game, pretty much because it adds everything. Gives you firepower, extra mobility, and as you can see, we have a big-ass machine gun on both sides, and then we have a beam cannon on both sides. And this is where it immediately shows there should be white on here, there should be gray on here, all kinds of colors, and we're not getting a single sticker for this here. But let's put it on. Oh yeah, still have to remove the hard point seal on the backpack. There we go. I'll find that after this review. Put it on there, and well, we have a red sticker on here and a red sticker on the other side. Whoop-de-doo, that's cute. Nice. So these go up and down. We'll just rotate around, nothing else. Then we're getting yet another weapon, the beam bazooka. And this is what I was talking about, why it's really unfortunate that we're only getting them in one color, because yeah, it's a nice blue bazooka, which really should be in gray. We're putting it on there. Oh, and this hand is the same one that was used with the beam rifle. You only get one. Ah, damn peg. So as I was saying, you only get one trigger finger hand. So the best way to put this is underneath the shoulder, and it fits really well thanks to that hand, really well designed trigger finger hand. Or you could always, well, let's just pull it off like that. Or you can also hold it over the shoulder because it is a bit wobbly in there. And if we put this up here, but as you can see, you can kind of lock it with the shoulder. So that's going to look pretty good either way you want to. Or you can... So, or you can put it on the backpack. On... Where'd the back skirt go? Ah, man. Or you can put it on the back skirt. Things are just falling apart with this thing. And that is why I questioned the text on the front. Now, where'd that peg go? Oh yeah, this one didn't have a peg. So yeah, that's a genius idea. Storing something on there that could have a peg without a peg. So now it's gonna kinda hold on to it. There we go, just be careful. I guess the one cool thing is that at least your bazooka isn't gonna have a random peg, and it does kinda hold on to it, though I would recommend just holding it in the hand because it is a badass weapon. But let's go with that for now. And look at the other things we're getting. So, these things here go onto the arm. Now, I always wondered what these were in the game, because they didn't seem to serve any purpose whatsoever. And there goes the bazooka. Let's put that back in. Nobody saw that. So, I always wondered what these were in the game, but apparently these are the 6-ton propellant tanks. Clicking it on there. There we go. No, something went wrong. And that is something that can be a bit annoying. These pegs here... whatever. So, these pegs here... The polycaps kind of like to turn around. So, I would also recommend gluing these shut. Especially if you want to easily... replace the pegs. There we go. So sometimes they'll immediately go in there, sometimes you have to fill around with them a little bit. Same goes for the legs. And these are the 17-ton propellant packs. Did I mention things like the fly off on this kit? Well, let's put that back in there. And this is gonna be a long review. So we're gonna grab the other one and on it, hopefully. I'm just gonna give up. There we go, and that is not everything, because you also get some extra ammo packs to go on the side skirt. So really using most of the hard points we're getting. And like I said, unfortunately, not really getting a lot of different colors here, but overall it doesn't look too bad. I mean, the main color of this thing is supposed to be blue, so at least that is something. And let's have a look at the stickers that we're getting to at least kind of attempt to make up for the lack of color. Well, we're getting red triangles on either side, and here we're also getting red triangles on either side. And black triangles with a yellow dot on it on either side. So, yeah, that is something. It's unfortunate that they couldn't just give us two colors, blue and gray. That really would have made the appeal of this thing much bigger. But as it is, well, from afar, it doesn't look too bad. And you can very easily replicate the pose it does in the video game. And before I forget, these white circles are also stickers. The one thing that kind of bugs me is that there are these two black stripes on there, but they're not molded into the model kit. Once again, it seems like they really want us to use the stickers rather than painting it. Moving on with my second F90 here. Mind you, you only get one F90 base model with all three packs, but this is here for illustrative purposes, so that you can see all three packs neatly stacked next to each other. So moving on with the destroyed pack, first of all, we're getting some stuff to go on his shoulders this time. These are the grenade launchers, putting them on there. Now, another first we're getting here are the two cracker grenades, which go on his front skirts. There we go. On they go, kind of have to lock it, come on. There it goes. Looks like this one has to be a bit more to the left. And that's it there. So, that's that already. Then moving on with the weapon we're getting with this set, and this is a very nice looking Gatling gun, but unfortunately it attaches to the back. Come on, be careful of the thrusters, be careful of everything else, don't make things fall off, please. I'm not even gonna mention it anymore. Oh yeah, and then you have to make sure that while you're... Fine, I'll do it like this. Then you have to make sure that while you're putting it in, this anchor claw goes in between, and then you put it on there, and there it goes. Also, a little bit of movement there. Now to put the back skirt back on there, and to put the arm back on there, click it goes, and now I have to say that these thrusters do kind of get in the way, so I would almost recommend putting it on there the other way around, but this really is the way you're supposed to put it on there. So put the arm in again, then we'll kind of have it look like he's somewhat holding on to it. There we go. Then for some more weapons, we're getting the missile pods, and these also have some white stickers on them. Pretty big white stickers. Once again, it would have been cool if we had two colors for each weapon set rather than just the one main color. And once again, gonna get in trouble with those polycaps. There we go. That goes in there, and unfortunately, these are not made to turn around, because there's another peg here, which goes in there, and it's really designed so that the arm goes into the pod. Come on it goes. So, well, you can kind of have it like this, but then it's gonna look quite weird with that giant hollow part right there, so it's really supposed to turn around like that, and go in. There we go. Another sticker is this white one here, and just as the white one on there, the black here, the black cross, isn't molded into the part. It's like there's a pattern emerging, and that is really annoying. Just mold it into the part already if you're gonna put it on the sticker. If it's supposed to be there, mold it into the model kit. Then, some really cool leg accessories, some booster pods, just put them on there, there we go. That goes on there. Just gotta be careful nothing falls off. And then finally, we're getting this extra ammo clip, which can go on either side skirt. So you can put it either on here or on the other side, whichever side you want. Oh, it might be a good idea to put it on the right side, and then you can always store the beam rifle onto the right side. Just gonna put this on the left side, and it's not gonna get in the way of the Gatling gun Anyway, so there we go. Actually, kind of unfortunate that we only get one extra ammo clip here, and two with the assault type. But that's all for the destroy type. And I think this one suffers the least from having only one color, because gunmetal gray is quite a nice military color, so that's not going to be too bad if it's just pure gray. There we go. Finally, the last pack is the support pack. And for that, I bring you my final F90. Let's hook up the stuff we're getting with this machine. First of all, we're getting a very nice cannon pack with two stickers on here. Yay! And it's molded entirely in green. Just put that on there in it. Goes, come on. And there we go. And this pack is very, very difficult to remove from the pack, from the backpack. Believe me, it's a major pain. So if you want to use the support backpack, be absolutely sure that you want to use it. And then for articulation, well, pretty much what you'd expect. The cannons go up and down, and these extra anchor things, I guess they are, kind of lock on there, or maybe they're sensor bars of some kind. Either way, they go up and down as well. So yeah, you can have a nice firing arc with these things. And I really love this accessory. It's a stand to give him some extra support, and that's a really cool thing. For some reason, I really, really enjoy what they did here. You know what? It's gonna fall off anyway. So yeah, this is one advantage of having a very easily removable back skirt. It is easy to just take it off and put on the accessories, or to remove it and remove the accessories. So that is one advantage of it, if you want to call that. So when you then just crouch the legs a bit, that is going to be absolutely perfect. So that is a really cool thing you can do with this. Then next up we have this here, which is going to connect to the front skirts. Just clip it on there. There we go. And I guess these are once again some extra sensors, because you know, you want to be absolutely sure that those giant cannons are going to hit. More artillery firepower are these giant missile things. Once again, should be painted, but yeah, the green drab military color doesn't look too wrong. Just put them on either sides, and that's gonna look pretty neat too. Actually, I would almost recommend painting the entire thing in this kind of very militaristic green. And putting this hand back in there for the giant Gatling guns. And these are the back skirt almost fell off again. And then getting these on there can be quite a challenge sometimes. But looks like this time, no real biggie. Really like the spring here. Very flexible. And also because it's just a metal spring, you don't have to worry about it cracking over time like you would have to with a rubber hose kind of thing. So that's really, really cool. Now finally, that the design, what was it again that they were saying on the box? We did every technique we could do. Well, you really did it this time. Credit where credit is due. And then put on the... I just praise it, and this happens. Fantastic. So, just put this on here, and once again, attach this to the side. Also, the spring connects really, really well to the pegs on here. So I have to say, once again, the Destroyed looking pretty good, even though it's in one single color. It would have been better if it wasn't two colors. But, you know, with this kind of color, it's not as bad. Let's put it like that. Also, for stickers, well, we once again have some yellow ones on the top there. And that is everything we're getting with this here. So open this aside, and then I almost forgot about one final accessory we're getting, the beam sabers. It's cool that they're giving us clear beam ones, clear blue ones, and well, you have the ones on here, but unfortunately, they're really just for decoration. You pull them out, throw them away, paint a handle here, and put this in here. Or I guess you could, if you really don't want to paint, but you do have some glue, you could clip off a piece here, cut this off and just glue it on there. If you want to have the lazy way of getting a good looking beam saber. Also, go into the hands, pretty damn nice. And then there is also a fully equipment type in the SD Gundam game, so let's see how we can replicate that thing. There we go, and well, I guess it's very asymmetrical? Also, I had to double check with the manga to see which leg option he used, and apparently he uses giant missiles, even though apparently in the SD Gundam G Generation Wars game, he can't use those. So I thought they were gonna give him the assault type boosters, but apparently not. I guess it really wanted to go full armament more than fully equipped. Or go crazy and come up with your own machine. And that's really the biggest fun about this set. There are so many combinations to make. You can make the support type with all the fuel tanks of the assault type to have a very long-lasting, endless amount of fire. So really a lot of combination you can do just with this set alone, or some even better news, because from other sets, I bring in these three here, and believe it or not, but all three of these are in some way actually compatible with the weapons I just showed. So let's see just how compatible each one of these are. And the one thing I really love is the G cannon here was actually made before the F90s, and then this one here from the Silhouette Formula and the Gun Blaster, these guys were made off them, so they still kept the F90 design in mind when creating these. So you could, because we of course are gonna have a lot of things left over, you only have one F90 with three equipment packs, so you can actually use all of your leftover equipment with these guys here. So let's go for it. And here are they with their varying degrees of compatibility. First of all, the Cluster Gundam is absolutely perfect. I even felt that all of the accessories went on there much easier than on the actual F90. Especially the arms, the polycaps were much less of a pain. Maybe it was a fluke this time, but or maybe it's just because it's in remodel and they got some of their design techniques a bit better. One big unfortunate thing is, like I said, all of these, well, the hard points are identical to those of the F90. So the one really unfortunate thing is, it cannot take the backpack. And there's no way to even swap out the entire backpack, like give it the beam saber backpack, which mounts the assault, well, which mounts all the extra add-on backpacks. No, it just straight out won't take him. How awesome would it have been if there was just this little hole in here? Or, well, I guess it's a challenge for everyone watching. If you think this looks pretty damn cool, just make your own hole, put a polycap through there, and there you go. So I guess it's not that hard to fix it, but that would have been awesome if he could also take the backpacks. So far, Cluster Gundam, absolutely perfect. Moving on to the Gun Blaster here, almost perfect too, but the same problem as the Cluster Gundam, the backpack won't take it. Well, you can't put the pack in the backpack, and you can't swap out the backpack either. One thing I have to say is the cluster does have more hard points than the gun blaster. The gun blaster doesn't have the hard points on top of his shoulders and doesn't have the hard points on the front skirts. He does, however, have the hard points on the backpack, on the back skirt, I mean. But in order to mount the Gatling gun, he will have to hold it upside down, because otherwise the ammo belt, if I can show it, there we go, otherwise the ammo belt will, the ammo belt just gets in the way of the backpack, so that is one thing you will have to do. Also, the hard points on the legs are slightly higher, so yeah, it's not going to be an absolute perfect fit as with the cluster Gundam, but it'll work. And perhaps the most surprising of all is the G-Cannon here, and the same goes for the G-Cannon Magna. Fit absolutely perfectly on the legs, especially this one here, because hey, why not add a few extra missiles to your G-Cannon or G-Cannon Magna? Also, beam rifle fits into the hand pretty well, fits almost perfectly in the Gun Blaster's hand, and the Cluster Gundam also holds the accessories pretty damn good. Now, let's change out the weapons. There we go, the Cluster Gundam is once again absolutely perfect. Unfortunately, now the stand that attaches to the back skirt is kind of obsolete because we don't have the very nice giant cannons on there, because it just won't attach there. Then the Gun Blaster also holds on to the Beam Bazooka just great, like the Cluster Gundam. But the one thing I do have to warn you guys about is that the arm and leg attachments, the propellant tanks, they're on there very, very loosely. The pegs are just a bit too short, and the ones on the arms are kind of prone to falling off. Especially the one on the left for some reason. The one on the right, yeah, just barely made it. But yeah, it's a very bare, it's almost no connection at all, but it works. So there's that, and then, well, the G-Cannon, the leg equipment works just fine, and now we have a high-speed G-Cannon. Yet again, the Cluster Gundam is a pretty good fit. Though I have to say, the legs here, they don't, well, the leg thrusters don't really go onto the legs as well. They will go on there, but they just don't really sit flush with the protruding part there. But it's still pretty good. Also, the grenade launchers that latch onto his shoulders, they can't really go on the way they're supposed to, because the thruster here, or whatever that's supposed to be, a thruster, yes, is a bit too long, so you will have to kind of put it like this. But other than that, oh yeah, and just like the Gun Blaster, you will have to put the Gatling gun upside down, or that ammo belt is, well, the ammo belt just gets in the way of the backpack. Then, the Gun Blaster, also really good fit, but I really like the way those giant missiles go in there, because their base is rounded and the hard point on the Gun Blaster is also round, so it looks like they were made for each other, and that's a really cool fit. Then the Gatling guns, they're, well, they will go on there, but you will, yeah, it's a bit of an uncomfortable endeavor to get them to fit on there. First of all, the trigger finger has to point forwards in order to get the hands in there, and you do have to push it a bit. You will have to squeeze to get it in there, so it might not feel really comfortable. I was a bit worried about getting stretch marks on there, but it apparently turned out quite all right. And then, well, once again, just as with the Cluster Gundam, the stand on the back, it looks a bit, well, kind of useless. Also, he has to crouch significantly more than the Cluster Gundam. Then moving on to the G-Cannon, well, he can hold on to the bazooka pretty well. That's all I can say, because the polycaps are in there pretty deep, and as I already said with the Gun Blaster, the pegs just don't go far enough, so he can't use those. But that's how all three of them work with all of the packs. So in short, they definitely have varying degrees of compatibility, but overall it is still very fun to play around with them, and if you have some leftover things flying around, it's great to kind of give them to those, like give a G-Cannon some extra weapons, give the gun blasters some extra boost, or things like that. It's just, it's really cool to see that they really incorporated all of this in the later model lines. And as a final note, of course, all of these different packs are all compatible with the F90-2 because the hardpoints are literally the same. I mean, the arms are the same, the shoulders are the same, and the legs are slightly different, but then the scourge armor is once again exactly identical. As always, the inevitable question is, do you want to buy this? And well, for 2,500 yen, this is a pretty expensive set. Now, we're getting a lot of stuff with it, getting the one base model and then the three packs, so it's definitely a fair price. We could say 1,000 yen for the base machine, and then 500 yen for each backpack, and well, for each pack set. So it's definitely a fair price, but the problem is, other than the ability to swap out accessories, you know, this thing doesn't really have anything screaming by me, because it does have various problems with it. First of all, the arms are such a pain. It really kind of saps out your enjoyment, because you're just trying to change a few things. You're trying to pose it, bam, the arm falls off. You're trying to pose it again, the other arm falls off. You try to pose it again, both arms fall off. You try to pose it again, you pay attention to the arms, the back skirt falls off. There's always something that's kind of going on, so it definitely has that annoyance factor. And then the packs themselves, well, you could say those are kind of like the main attraction. Hey, you've got the packs, they're interchangeable, but they're all molded in one color. So, yeah, I'm gonna grab the thing again, the piece of cardboard here. Yeah, for the time, they could have definitely said this about certain models, but saying it about this machine, it feels like it always has those little... there are just too many of those quirks going on here. Just the little things that should have been better to really make it stand out amongst the other machines of the time. Because 2,500 yen does sound really expensive for... And also, keep the size in mind. These are not big things. Here is the standard sized Jim Kai. As you can see, this isn't a big thing we're talking about. It's not like some kind of giant model kit. This is a pretty small thing. And when we start comparing it with other machines of the time, a fair comparison would be here the RXF-91. This is 1,400 yen, and it's a lot better, I would say, with the entire package. So whether or not you want to buy this really depends on how much you like those backpacks. For example, I really, really like the assault backpack. For me, it was worth getting it. I love the assault pack, and I will find a use for all the spare parts. It's a lot of fun combining things and making your own custom thing, but if you really want it to look absolutely great, you're gonna have to paint it. And even then, I have to say that I really do like the retro look of these, but I can't really say yes or no, because it's just gonna depend too much on whether or not you like it. And really, with this is the case, because when we look at some other machines, here is the Hardy gun, which is a great model kit. For 1,000 yen, you can get 2.5 Hardy guns. For these, yes, a Hardy gun was a great price value, but still, it's just, I can't wholeheartedly recommend it. If you like the way it looks, if, for example, you have some other F91s and you can swap out more parts, then yes, you can make it worth it. But as it stands now, if you have no interest in these guys, this is definitely not gonna change your mind. If you've played a game, they're gonna be really fun things to have. Put them next to your game, but other than that, well, there are just too many shortcomings. They should have put more effort into the backpack. They really should have shown us a bit more of their techniques. We did every technique we could do. Yeah, thank you, lying box. I mean, maybe this is the biggest offense, just blatantly lying to you the second you open the box. This is the first thing you see. Ah, great model kit. Another great Gundam from Bandai. And let's look at it like this. If I bought this model back then and they said that this right here is the epitome of their technological advancement and the best thing they could do at the time, and I wasn't aware of actual great Molochists like the Hardy Gun or the RX-F91, then I would have thought, well, you guys aren't that great. I mean, it's okay. So yeah, that's all about that. Let's wrap up with some size comparisons. First of all, to really put the size of this thing into scale, here is the 1/100 scale Monster Grade Jim Kai again, and here is the 1/144 scale Unicorn Destroy Mode. As you can see, the Unicorn is actually bigger. So yeah, that's the size we're talking about. Once again, going to the price value thing. And now let's compare it to some of its contemporary machines. Here is the RX-F91 again. As you can see, even that thing is bigger than this machine here. And here is next to the F91, I'm sorry. Because the F91 was based on the data collected by all of the F90 backpack model thingies. So it's really nice to see how they went. Though I have to say one thing, I have to make one thing absolutely clear. The F90 is definitely a better model kit than the F91. Then again, this is a lot cheaper than that. And finally, here he is next to the game. Well, that's all for this review, and see you guys next time.